Nitin Sobhan, and I'm going to talk on upper arterial Doppler. So what is very unusual about upper arterial Doppler is that, first of all, symptomatic arterial disease is less common in the upper limb as compared to lower limb. One of the most common presenting feature of upper limb ischemia is Raynaud's phenomenon. That means the patient gets episodes of discoloration in the fingertips, typically during cold season or sometimes even with an emotional trauma. In the upper limb, we need to think of systemic disorders, collagen disorders. We need to think of aortoarteritis, thoracic outlet syndrome, subclavian steel embolisms, which are more common in the upper limb as compared to lower limb. And then, of course, in the upper limb, very often patients have very good collaterals, and therefore symptoms are very often less. Here, for example, we have a patient who has got a complete occlusion of the subclavian artery, but there is an excellent collateral coming from the internal mammary artery, and ultimately the symptoms were not too bad. Trauma is very common in the upper limb, vascular trauma, typically either industrial accidents or agricultural accidents. Electroconvulsion injuries are very common in the upper limb. Very often, one of the most common indication for looking at upper limb arteries is, of course, evaluating arteries prior to an AV fistula or a graft for dialysis. And then, of course, we look at a palmar arch patency taking up the radial artery for CABG surgery. You have to be very familiar with the anatomy, just like any other examination. We always begin with the vertebral artery. That means we ask the patient to lie supine, extend the neck on the pillow, and then evaluate the vertebral artery along its entire extent in grayscale, on color, and in pulse Doppler. On color, make sure that the direction of flow in the carotid artery and the direction of flow in the vertebral artery are the same. And this is very important to pick up subclavian steel. Then keeping the position same, we look at the subclavian artery. Typically, we try and go as close to the origin as possible, and we tilt the beam towards the manubrium sternum in the proximal portion of the subclavian artery. And of course, as we go distally towards the axilla, then we like to tilt the probe on the opposite side. The subclavian artery typically is a very high resistance sort of artery with a very with the reversal of diastolic flow, and you might get a little forward flow a little later, but it's a very high resistance sort of a waveform. Now, one of the most important problems in subclavian artery is looking at origins of the subclavian artery, the origin of left subclavian artery and the origin of the brachiocephalic trunk. And this is because they are hidden by the bones. So what we do typically is either you use a cardiac probe, which has got a very small foothead, or we use a transvaginal probe and try and look at origins. But this is important because very often stenosis is at the origin of the subclavian artery. The axillary artery, of course, we evaluate by hyperextending the arm. And then it is easy to evaluate, but we should not give too much of pressure. Otherwise, very often, if you are also looking at a vein, the vein can get compressed. The brachial artery, typically, we go medially and trace it all along its extent, right from the axilla to its bifurcation. Now, it's very important to evaluate the brachial artery in a transverse plane also. This is because not only can we see the lumen well, but when you evaluate the brachial artery in a transverse plane, we can pick up any anomalies of the brachial artery. For example, very often we see a high bifurcation of the brachial artery coming up in the upper arm. And this is a very important information which we need to give to surgeons before doing a fistula surgery. It is very important to look at the brachial artery bifurcation. So that's a brachial artery bifurcation with the radial artery, of course, going superficially and the ulnar artery going down. So then we trace the entire radial artery right from its origin. It is easy to evaluate because it is superficial. And as you go distally again, we see a sort of a high resistance waveform. This patient is elderly, and usually in elderly, we get a very high resistance waveform in the radial artery. Then we look at the ulnar artery. As we know that the ulnar artery dips down at its origin, the mid portion of ulnar artery is very often difficult to see. But once you come closer to the wrist, then the ulnar artery becomes superficial, and again, it becomes easy to evaluate. There are some tests which we need to do in the upper limb. One test is known as Allen's test. This is done to look at palmar arch patency, to find out if the palmar arch is patent before we take the radial artery for bypass surgery. So what we do is look at the radial artery, compress the ulnar, and look out for this increase in velocity. Then we look at the ulnar, compress radial, and again look out for increase in velocity. This increase in velocity typically should be at least 30 to 40 centimeters per second. So here we are doing the Allen's test. We are looking at the radial artery, compressing the ulnar artery, and then we look out for this increase in velocity. Here we are looking at the ulnar artery, compressing the radial artery, and then again looking out for this increase in velocity. There is something known as a modified duplex Allen's test, where we typically keep the probe, a small footed probe, in the snuff box, look at the radial artery here, and then compress the proximal radial artery. So if the palmar arch is patent, then again we get reversal of flow coming from the ulnar artery, and once you see a reversal like this, that means again that the palmar arch is patent. Then there is a test known as reactive hyperemia. This is done typically again before fistula. Typically what we are looking out for is an increment in the blood flow after a pilvic fistula. Now this test tells us whether the artery is able to dilate adequately after ischemia, not only after ischemia, but if it is, if once there is a fistula done, as we know, that there is an increased demand in the blood, and the artery should be able to cope up this increased demand. And this test is good for that. So typically what we do is ask the patient to hold the fist tight and then evaluate the radial artery. Typically what we see is a very high resistance sort of a waveform. Then we ask the patient to release the fist, and after releasing fist, typically what we see is an increase in the diastolic flow. That tells us that the artery is good for dialysis. This is what we are doing here. That's the patient, we are looking at the radial artery. The fist is very tight and we can see there's a high resistance. In fact, there's a reversal of flow. And after releasing the fist, there's a reactive hyperemia, and we can see that there's increase in the diastolic flow. This is a normal sort of a response. We can also look at the palmar arch, and we can also look at the flow in the digital arteries. Now, this typically we do when the patient is suspected to have a small arterial disease. That means typically, for example, if everything is fine up to the radial and ulnar artery, but the patient still has Raynaud's, that is the time you will start looking at small arteries in the palm or in the fingers. There are some other tests, like, for example, we look out for thoracic outlet compression. There are three or four tests which you can do. One is Addison's test. In this, what we do is ask the patient to stand, droop down the ipsilateral hand which you are evaluating, and ask the patient to tilt on the same side of where we are evaluating and take a deep breath in. So typically, if the patient has a thoracic outlet problem, then we can see that the radial artery becomes weak either clinically. What we can also do is keep our ultrasound probe and look out for alteration in the waveform. There's a test known as neck tilting test or a reverse Addison. Typically, what we do here is ask the patient to look on the opposite side of the examination. And again, if the patient does not have a thoracic outlet, then there is no significant alteration in the waveform. There are other tests. For example, there is something known as a costoclavicular compression test. There's Wright's test, which is an hyperabduction test. There's a Roos test. This is what we commonly do in our practice. So what we do is ask the patient to raise the hands, hyperextend, hyperabduct, and then move the fingers. You can look at a radial artery, but this becomes very cumbersome. So commonly what we do is look at the subclavian artery or the axillary artery. And we'll see a case subsequently. Then there is a test which is known as cold stimulation test for Raynaud syndrome. So again, when you're suspecting a systemic disorder like an SLE, a patient is symptomatic, has clinically a Raynaud syndrome, then what we do is a cold stimulation test. So here what we do is ask the patient to hold some ice in the hand till the patient is able to hold it, maybe typically 15 seconds or so. Look at a waveform. Typically after holding the ice, it's a very high resistance waveform, and you can see a reversal of flow in the diastole. Then we ask the patient to release the eyes, and typically in a normal patient, after 1 minute, 2 minutes, or at the most 3 minutes, you can see that the waveforms can come back to normal. Very often you might get a higher diastolic flow. This is a normal response to a cold stimulation test. So why do we look at the vertebral first is to pick up subclavian stain, because once you have a subclavian stain, your diagnosis is simple and the examination is over in a matter of 2 minutes. So here, for example, we have a patient who has got a complete steal on the left side. The vertebral artery is blue and there's an occlusion of the subclavian artery. And on the right side, there's a partial steal. That's a typical funny bunny sign. And the patient has a stenosis at the origin of the brachiocephalic trunk. We can have subclavian artery occlusion. So typically when you have a thrombus, prior to the occlusion, you get this high resistance waveform. There's multiple waves typically happening in the diastole because the blood goes and hits against a dead wall. And distally, of course, you get a dampened flow. That's a patient who had a thoracic outlet symptoms. So we can see that the subclavian artery at rest has a velocity of about 80. After the Roos test, we can see that the velocity is increasing to about 300 or 400 centimeters per second, telling us that the artery is sort of narrowed down. And if you look at a vein, that's a normal subclavian vein at rest. And after the hyperabduction, hyperextension maneuver, there is narrowing of the subclavian vein with an increase in the velocity of the subclavian vein. So that is typical of thoracic outlet. In fact, me and Dr. Raju Wadhwa from Hinduja were the first to describe venous changes in a thoracic outlet syndrome many years back. Aorto arthritis is very common in the upper limb. Typically, subclavian artery is very often affected. And what you typically get is a long segment of narrowing, of wall thickening in the subclavian artery or the carotid artery. That's very classical of aorto arthritis, very common in the upper limb. We can have axillary artery stenosis with aliasing, narrowing of flow channels and very high velocities. We can have brachial artery occlusion. Now look at this, a number of collaterals. Very often there are a lot of collaterals which come up in the upper limb, but this patient of course has a dampened flow as we went distally. This lady had severe discoloration of the hand. You look at the fingers, and of course the cause was occlusion of the brachial artery. Both the ulnar and radial arteries were also occluded. It's a very bad case. In this era of COVID, we are seeing upper limb arterial occlusion because of the disease. We know that whenever there is a hypercoagulable state, there can of course be thrombosis. And the Virchow's triad consists of abnormal vessel wall, abnormal flow, and a hypercoagulable state. And typically in COVID, there are a lot of factors which contribute to these factors and ultimately can give rise to a hypercoagulable state and thrombosis. So we have seen patients presenting with upper limb ischemia who have subsequently turned out to be COVID positive. Here's a patient, young patient who came, did not have fever, had only upper limb pain, and there is an occlusion of the subclavian artery, the axillary radial and the ulnar arteries with severely dampened flow. Another patient, 45 years old, who had pain in both the forearms, again, not very symptomatic, had fever for 1 or 2 days, and both the radial artery and the the radial artery and the ulnar artery in both the forearms were occluded. And this is a patient again who had ischemic changes in the hand, and there was thrombosis of the right superficial palmar arch in the distal ulnar artery, and subsequently he had to be operated and they had to remove the thrombosis from the arteries. We can have changes in the fingers, typically in this can be because of atherosclerosis, but typically when we think of small arterial disease, we need to think of collagen disorders or systemic disorders like, for example, SLE. These patients, what we need to differentiate in the upper limb is an obstructive disease from a vasospastic disease, and we need to separate out a small arterial disease from major arterial disease. So typically major arterial diseases are up to the distal radial and ulnar, and they present more commonly with either obstruction or stenosis. Whereas typically a small arterial disease of the palm, typically for example collagen disorders, they present with a vasospasm or a vasospastic disorder. And a good test to look out for vasospasm, as we said, is the cold stimulation test. So what happens here is that after the patient, we ask the patient to hold cooled ice and release the ice, the waveforms do not come back to normal. We persistently see a high resistive waveform, and the patient typically complains of a lot of pain. So here's a young lady we did in Chestnut. She had SLE, and there's a persistent high resistive waveform, and this lasted for almost 20-25 minutes, and the patient had severe pain in the hand. I almost repented having done this test because of the pain which she had. Embolism is very common in the upper limb as compared to lower limb. Here's a person who came with upper limb pain early in the morning, in fact. And what we saw was a complete occlusion of the axillary artery because of an embolism. So we just put a probe on the heart and saw a source of embolism on the mitral valve. Here's a known case of mitral valve disease, of course. This is a person who had an accident in the industry. He was working on some machine and his hand sort of went partly in one of the part of the machine, and he developed a complete tear of the biceps muscle with the brachial artery occlusion. This is a gentleman who was traveling in the train, local train of Mumbai, and then someone hit a stone from outside and he injured his brachial artery and had a traumatic aneurysm of the radial artery. This is a gentleman working at the MSCB, accidentally touched a live wire and then had an electrocution injury of the left hand. And when he came to us, the entire hand was discolored and there was occlusion of the radial and the ulnar artery. So thank you so much for your attention. Upper limb evaluation is quite different from lower limb evaluation. The diseases are again quite different. And most important, remember that there are some special tests you need to do in the upper limb as compared to lower limb. Thank you so much.